whispering because I'm in the porch and it's 5 a.m. and we've had a delivery. So this is for the forklift that we've just bought. It's getting delivered today, and it's so that we can lift, obviously, the slabs, the wall panels, the floor panels, anything else that we're lifting in the CCTV cube, so we can do that a bit safer. It's obviously sliding to the forks, tighten up so they don't slide off, and then you've got obviously either this one if you hang it upside down, or the hooks on that side as well, yeah, for the chains you've got. So I'll get that in the van now.
So I can talk now. I'm in the van and I'm in the one of the tippers, the light tipper, because it's full of metal, copper, lead, cable, and you know, just non-ferrous as well. And we're on the way to S.Norton Scrap on the dock, so they open at 6. I've been up early today. I woke up, I don't know if anyone else has this issue, but I woke up this morning about 4 o'clock, and as soon as I'm up, like, you know, I'll try and tell myself that I'm going to go back to sleep, and I sit there and let my brain just start, you know, ticking away. And then I think, oh, don't look at my phone. And then I have a look at my phone, it's it, that's game over, I'm up. So I started looking on eBay, because I've been having ideas of, you know, how can we start using the yard, getting stuff in and out. So I'm going to order some bulk bags with hopefully the logo on. It'd be nice to drop some bulk bags off at the job with the logo outside. I think, you know what, we're actually getting somewhere. So I was looking at, obviously we've got the forklift at the yard that's coming today. Busy day today. And I feel like I'm able to get up and focus and crack on with today because I didn't drink. So literally this, obviously since I said I haven't drank any. I haven't had any alcohol, and like last night went and watched England, just had non-alcoholic beer or shandy, and yeah, feel 10 times better this morning for it, and I'm up early, and you know, hopefully work starts seeing some positive bits from not drinking. But we've got the forklift on the yard. However, when we get deliveries, or let's just say we pallet some bricks outside the job, I need to be able to go and pick them up. Perfect if I had a grab wagon. However, I haven't got an operator license yet, so I can't do that. We're not able to pick stuff up. But there are, shout out to Ray, who messaged me and said about his tipper. So he's a builder in Ireland, and he said he bought a 3.5 ton tipper, which between that and his tipper van, obviously you can carry a lot more weight. Saves us doing like so many trips back and forth. So I was looking at, you know, tipper trailers, but they're so expensive. Like, you're talking 7-8 grand upwards for, and I mean, a new one, I found a new one, they're about 28 grand or something like that. It's ridiculous. And then I was thinking, what about a tipper trailer with a high-ab crane? And then we could like lift them on. I was looking at the high-ab cranes thinking, oh, they don't look the best, the strongest. I was thinking, and then I found this trailer which does skips. So it's a trailer that drops skips off. Obviously, you can still only carry a certain weight. However, it's more than we can get on the tipper. And it means that we could drop skips outside the job and just take those as well as the tipper maybe. So I might look at getting one of them. And then I was looking at it thinking, maybe if we recycle bulk bags of hardcore, we can start selling bulk bags, and then this would be a way of delivering them safely. But again, the issue with that is that, like, you know, when we get a bulk bag delivered, sometimes you want the bulk bag to be like in a certain position. However, I've found now that the best place to put it is on the road, as if it was a car. If you start putting stuff on the pavement, the council is straight out. And you only put stuff on the pavement if you know it's getting moved straight away. What else are you going to mention? There's literally loads going on today. Oh yeah, I was laughing at like some of the comments we're getting from the shorts. So, I don't know if some of you have noticed that, you know, I've started putting a few shorts up because apparently the shorts are a better way to get subscriptions and views and stuff. So, I'll be hands up. I've done a bit of a clickbait ones with, like, you know, obviously the bay, the breast beam on the, I can't even pronounce it, breast summer beam on the bay. Basically, it was like sawdust. And when Mick, I thought, I come in the job and I see Mick obviously taking the archway out, but not the way I do it, where I take everything off it at a weight and there's like 10, 20 bricks fall. He's obviously done it where there was a bit more of a fall, and then I seen the beam broken. I said, did the archway fall on that? And he was like, no, it never. Said that happened when I was prising the floorboards up. So I was like, okay, take his word for it. And then I watched the video back, and I seen that when the chimney stacks down, that chimney breast, you can see on the video, I'll try and put one here or here, that like it hasn't broke. It's only when he has started prising the floorboards up. So, can't remember your name on YouTube, but I was big enough to hold my hands up and apologise to Mick, because I had to go with him for like, I thought he dropped the stack onto the floorboard and caused that to break. So I'm big enough to hold my hands up and think I know everything, and I didn't. I was wrong that he didn't do that. And later on, when I was feeling the timber, it was literally like sawdust, totally rotted away. So I'm big enough to hold my hands up and say I was wrong. I thought that, you know, through all the evidence that I'd figured it out, like Columbo, similar to this guy on YouTube who's watched a 30-second clip and is giving us, calling us cowboys and whatever else. Well, if you watch the video and you're a bigger man, hopefully I'll get an apology from you that, you know what, yeah, you were right that wasn't caused by that and you were wrong. And then we just get a few other bits, but it's part of, I'm surprised we haven't had more, to be fair, because that was one of my biggest worries, that, you know, you're trying to do everything right. However, there's always someone out there who will do it a different way, think they know better, call you a cowboy, like, whatever. So, but we're all here to learn. I've been doing this 14 years, and still every day I'm still learning new stuff. But yeah, just take everything with a pinch of salt, and if you think you're an expert, you're probably not. Because there's always someone who's more experienced, or I'd say, watch the long videos. Don't just watch a 30-second clip and think that you know everything. Watch the long videos, because people in there going, oh yeah, these don't have a clue what they're doing, when in fact that beam was broken and then swapped the same day with steels, which I don't know many who would do it that quick and act that quick and know how to prop it and where you can prop it, what times you can do the, or whatever. And then another one is that my dad's got a house, not in the middle of nowhere, but in the middle of nowhere compared to us, and he's got like a big garden, and I've always said to him that he's got like a separate entrance to his garden. I said, just get planning permission to build a 3-bed house on like that bit of your garden. And even if you don't build it, even if it lapses, as long as you've got that plan of permission, like, it'll bump the price of his house up, or, you know, if he ever needed to sell it or do anything, if he wanted to free some cash up out of his house, he's got that option. But just go through it so that it's there on record. And I think he's starting to finally take some of my advice. So I think that's something he wants to obviously do now. So I might bring that to you on the channel, that we'll go through measuring out. We're going to do a pre-application. It's in Chester, actually. So it'll be Chester City Council, not Liverpool. So theirs might be slightly different to Liverpool. So we'll do a pre-application, find out what they're thinking in terms of a 3-bed house, 100 metres squared, 120. Just what size we could get on there, if any. And yeah, hopefully go through that process, because it's a bit of a scary process for many people, but if we go through it on the channel and show you step by step, which I'm trying to do on the yard, and it is coming back to bite me a little bit. However, I'll just keep sharing what I think is relative. But yeah, 10 minutes of me in the van, I'll stop there, and we're gonna drop this off at Norton's, and then I'm back and I'm gonna be on the yard today. We've got concrete coming to concrete posting, and I've got to concrete some steels in the floor to take the sliding gate mechanism, because obviously the gates are going to weigh a bit, and over years and years and years we don't want them to sink or go out of line. And you say how hard it is to get in touch with planning and to get a reply sometimes for what you do. The day we put those steels in on Friday, the next morning at like 9 o'clock in the morning, I had an email off the planning consultant, Darren, saying, "Hi, we've had planning enforcement on, saying that I've like begun to do fencing that I haven't got planning for yet, and that, you know, it can only be a metre high until I have planning, or you can build it, but you risk the planning might say no to it, and then you either got to take it down or change it." However, I'm absolutely flabbergasted that I've emailed planning and I've said, "Right, I want to do this fence, that fence," and they've said, no, wait for it. And I said, "Okay, how about I put this fence up, the one I want, the one I think that solves everyone's problems, and if I don't get it, I will put the old fence back in front of the new fence, so it will be identical to what it was." So I thought literally that was, you know, me being reasonable and trying to progress the site and make it more aesthetically for neighbours, for everyone. However, even that got like an objection to it, and you're thinking, like, what can you do? Literally, so I bought the yard. It had a wooden fence that was like burnt down, by the way, and like held up by the shed. I've took it down. If I want to put that exact same fence back up, they're saying no, I need planning permission for that now. And you just think, where does it, like, I don't know whether they're just being difficult with me because of all the objections, or whether they genuinely like don't want me to put any fence up at all. They just want, but either way, those posts, whatever fence we have, those posts will be there. So whatever fence planning allow me to have, the fencing will get attached to those posts. So I can't see surely me getting any more emails off planning about the fence posts, but this is obviously some of the battles you've got to go through to even get a fence on the yard. I did not think the fence would be an issue, really. I didn't even know you needed planning to change a fence, but there you go. Here we are, pulling up to Norton and Co. Limited. Look at that chute. So that chute is actually off at the minute, but that chute just constantly pumps, obviously, bits out. I don't even know whether we're allowed in. I might be too early. It's only half fat, or 20 to 6. I think we open at 6. I might be too early. Maybe I should have had a beer last night. Now the lads have done really well, not. And they've like, you'd think that they'd section everything, so like lead in one bit, copper in the other, but no, there's like copper just mixed in with everything, really. So I've now got to fish through everything at the bottom to get it all out now. So the lads have loaded this absolutely awful. Like, obviously they've never been on a scrap run before, or just being lazy, but I'm gonna have to tip this now, and then I'm gonna have to pick through and get all the copper wire lead out of this now and put it back on the van, and then go back over to the other weighbridge. You see this pile here, is the machine that conveyor belt goes into an absolute, I think that runs at 5,000 RPM, just shreds stuff, absolutely obliterates it, and then it goes through the plant there and gets separated. 56 kilograms of copper, not bad from one house. We've got three more to do, and then we've got cable and lead. Didn't get much lead. Didn't get much lead in that one, did we? What do we have? 12 kilograms of lead. And what's lead at now? 130. And we had 28 of mixed cable.
Yes.
So it's 6:30. 6:25 now, so good to get that out the way. The tip is now clear, and what we're going to do now is this tip will go to the yard, and as the lads are sorting through the bricks, we're going to have a conveyor from the bottom of the concrete crusher onto this tipper, and as they're going through the bricks, any half bricks or quarters or whatever else will get lashed in the brick crusher, and that'll go straight onto here, and then this will be getting taken to the job, then the student job, and we're going to backfill obviously the ground floor up, ready for insulation and concrete once we've dug the extension. But it'd be good to get that levelled out again. It took a bit longer, but I'm going to stay in a positive mood because, you know, I'm now covered in crap because I had to go root through the whole thing because the lads didn't realise that, yeah, when I get to the when you get to that yard, obviously you get paid different amounts. So I think he said it was £6 odd for copper, so that means for obviously £6 odd for a kilogram, or you know, 600 and something for a ton. Well, if you've got a ton of copper, you're flying. Oh, sorry, £600 for 100 kilograms. A ton would be what, £6,000? And again, lead is, I think he said lead was £1.30. I thought it was more than that. And the mixed wire, I think the mixed wire was more than that. I'll find out once they've processed it. So they used to do like cash and whatever, cash in hand on the scrap things, and that's why you'd have loads of dodgy fellas driving around in scrap vans and going and getting cash, but the government have stopped all that now, so you have to go through bank transfers so that they can keep a track of everything, basically. Yeah, that's it. We are another recycling for the Eco Builders. Maybe at the yard I'll have a cable stripper. Might be good. So if I had a cable stripper, we could throw all the cable through ourselves. And or I've even seen the company I get the crusher off in China do a rather than a cable stripper, you just lash the cable in and it just separates it. Don't ask me how. Just literally obliterates it and it comes out in shavings. However, like the copper drops out and then all the rubbish goes out the other side. Oh, I've nearly gone the wrong way. Yeah, again, all this stuff we can do that as we're bringing stuff back just, you know, makes more profit, makes it more recycling, makes it more efficient, but also costs more money. You've got to invest to get stuff back. Although it does feel like there's just a lot of investment one after another. Right, some of the lads won't even be up yet, so I can't message in the group yet, but I need to sort out who's in, who's watched the England game and had too many and is off, and who's coming to work. We will see. So it's 7 o'clock and I'm on the yard, and I didn't realise just how many bricks we had. Literally got, and I just thought I need to go and get some wrap for this, so I'm thinking we're just going to be okay with like cling film. I'll just go and get some cling film, as long as we wrap it enough times. You know, if we use a pound's worth of cling film on each pallet, what have we got now?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We've got 9, 10. 10 pallets we've got now. We've got 4,000 brick. And then we've still got those piles to go through. So as you can see, we've got loads of halves and three quarters and stuff that are maybe getting in the way of the lads picking the full ones. However, I need the forklift here, don't I? Because I need to be able to get the reverse the tipper in up to the crusher so that we can put it straight on as we crush it. It just goes straight on with a conveyor into the... and then I wanted to put an adapter on the crusher so we can just plug in the 110 converter and obviously use the shifters without having to use another extension lead. And then I've got to swap the auger for the probably the 300mm bucket or the 600mm bucket. I'll see, yeah. But yeah, I'm excited for today. Just popping into Tesco to get some cling film. Never thought I'd be buying cling film for the builder's yard, but here we are. To be honest, I wasn't sure whether this would work, but it seems to have done the job. As long as I can pick it up with the forklift and it doesn't shift, so I'll get these other ones wrapped. I'll have set me back doing that. It's definitely a two-man job. Especially the first one, the first loop round. As long as it grips the other bit, it's fine. But getting that first loop round was the hard bit. I have this plan in my head of like what's going to happen, and then I get here and I go, one, we can't get to the crusher. So I was going to put the tipper up to the crusher and have a conveyor belt on, and we were going to throw like the half bricks in as we were getting the full ones. But the forklift's getting delivered around lunchtime, in which case we can obviously pick these up and move them elsewhere. So if you can get, just obviously keep working through this now, getting full bricks on the pallets and wrapping them, I'm gonna go and get the other van, and we've got these steels got delivered on Friday. And what these are for, the sliding gates. So this will get welded to that steel and that steel. So there's a gate here and a gate, obviously, the other end. So then we put, obviously, the length of the gate. So that one's 7.5, this one's 6.5. So there'll be 6.5 meters. And then obviously the gate needs to slide 6.5 meters. So obviously we've got 13 meters of steel. I was gonna try and get them in one go, but they said they're just too flexy. So we've done them in two, and we'll weld, obviously, a plate down the middle of them. And then we're gonna concrete them in. So this is so, obviously, when the gate's on over like 10, 15, 20 years, it just doesn't sink. Because you imagine like a heavy gate moving back and forward every day, it'd eventually sink. So we sit them on the steel so that it doesn't flex and it stays straight, and we've got something to weld the track to. And we're gonna dig 300mm, so I'm gonna swap the auger for a 300mm bucket. I'm gonna dig a 300mm trench, 14 meters long. And then we're gonna sit these in and concrete them in so that they're sat perfect. And then obviously we'll concrete these posts in and obviously the steel for the sliding gate at the same time. So we need to get the final post in on there. However, we've got two extension leads here and it doesn't reach that corner. And that's just reminded me that at some point today I need to go to Burdens and pick up the, I'm gonna dig a trench from here all the way along to the utility hut, and that we're going to run ducting, obviously, to have sockets all the way along, sockets and water along this front, so that, you know, we haven't got to put two extension leads to get, well, three extension leads to get to that corner. We'll just run a cable and obviously have a socket sort of spaced out wherever we think we need to. Right, back in a minute. Not a bad start to Monday morning. It's 8:15 and I've just got a text off my mate at S.Norton's, and he said we've got £455 worth of metal we've just dropped off. So not bad. That will go towards buying what? Two, would it buy two? I can't remember what they are. Two flags for
the ground, or it might pay for the ducting. We'll see how much the ducting is. So I need to try and get this concrete ready. So I always try and book in the concrete, because it gives you like a deadline. It gives you something to like to you know, to like focus on and be like, right, we need to be ready for that. So we won't be like going for like a little break at 10 and doing this. It'd be like, get it all ready for the concrete, and then we can go and have like an early lunch or whatever. Or hopefully we do get it all ready for the concrete. But yeah, once that's in, it's just like I can feel like I'm starting, the yard starting to come together. Then it feels good. Then so I'm going to be using the 300mm booklet. However, it comes with obviously the ones that come in and out where we used to have to knock the pins out. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to tack weld these for now, because we've got the quick hitch now. We won't be taking these pins in and out. So, as you can see, hopefully that'll hold it on for now, and then if we ever need to swap these, I can just grind them off. Quick hitch. There we go. And start digging the trench here. So we've hit a bit of a snag, haven't we? This pin keeps popping out. I'm tempted to weld it again, but I've greased it, so I'm not sure why it keeps popping out. And again, I've greased this one and that one. The bolts sheared off, so I've had to put like just a temporary one in for now, just to get this dug so we can get the concrete in. Just gonna go and get the grease gun now and just make sure everywhere is greased again. But we've got this dug out, so by the time I realised that, well, from there to there, 6.5, so that's a 6 metre gap. So 6.5 metres is there, and then that's a 7.5. So 7.5 comes to there. So we only had like this little stretch here, and I thought, let's just join the two so it's stronger. So we're gonna whack it, hardcore it, and then put the steels in, and then concrete it, and it'll be one from obviously that steel all the way through. Will be one strip of concrete then, which will obviously be better than doing it in sections. So Scott and Mick have just come back after, what have you been doing? Messing around with the roof. Yeah. But yeah, borrowed some scaff this morning and brought it back. And then I've talked them into helping us get ready for this concrete. And then something else has just arrived. So you can see me and Lou have got this. What we're going to do is whack a plate this now, put hardcore in it, keep whacking it. And then get it up to the level where the steel sits flat, and have another break. Yeah, steel sits flat, and then we're ready for concrete if I push the concrete back. But yeah, there's a little surprise. You alright? I'm guessing that's one of the smallest things you've had on your truck.
All sorts of things.
Right now I'm going to whack all the way along this trench, get it hard. Lou's going to start dropping hardcore in as Scott and Mick sort of clear the trench and get it a bit smoother. And then once we're happy with how it's whacked with the hardcore down up to the height, I'm going to weld the steels to the uprights. And then we're going to concrete round them. Yeah, Jay, I like this bit of appetizing. So we've gone for a C30 mix, which is a bit of a stronger one. So as you can see, we've got this bit in now. We're going to whack it, we're going to pour concrete, and then sit the steel in, and I'm going to weld the steels in place. And
then we've got to finish that bit down there whilst obviously just starting that corner loop by the post. Just tip it close. It'll spill in, won't it? First barrel. There we go. We're going to have that all the way along here, so hopefully, obviously, that'll be strong enough to hold these steels and this all as one unit. Try and get it in the trench. Right. If me and you try and do that bit now. Oh yeah, do get one more there. One more here, Scott.
Yeah, that's it. So we've got, obviously this is where the sliding gate's gonna go. So what we've just done is string line from that steel to this steel and to the end, so that it's in a perfect line, so there's no bend in the gate. And then what I'm gonna do is, I've just scratched these bits off. I'm gonna try and weld this on now.
Who's going to put the wrong one on? I won't forget this time.
Look at the state of me. Yeah, you've been working hard enough. So what you can see now is we've got one big like foot in the concrete almost. The only thing we didn't have time to do was the corner post, wasn't it? We'll just mix that by hand. And then obviously where this post is. Oh, actually I'll probably cement that bit in, you know. I'll get some cement from there and finish this bit so it's all one, just for that one. You can see, obviously, this is where the track for the sliding gate will go. So we're going to have, when you're looking at it from inside, you'll see that far one. There'll be a gate that slides open. And from this section here, there'll be a gate that just slides over to that section. That's why, obviously, the steels are twice as long as the gates are. And then what we've this is what we pulled off. There was loads of these, obviously the old fence posts, literally loads of them. So all the way along we've been pulling them up, and what we're going to do tomorrow is I've got to get the forklift in. Oh no way, I'll have to bring it in here. I can't believe we forgot that. Yeah, we wouldn't have, would we? Thank you to Scott and Mick, although they'll probably get half a day for that, won't they? Definitely needed them. But yeah, it's starting to come together. And then so I can order concrete panels up to a metre, or I can go ahead and order them and have all the timber ready to clad the front if, or whatever the planning asks for. But yeah, next thing will be obviously the track rods. Well, no, next thing is we're going to break up all these. Look at the size of these. So these are all the old slabs here. So people didn't know that this was actually all concreted.
Do you remember when we had to break the concrete out to like dig around some of the old roots and stuff? But next thing would be, I'm going to go to Burns tomorrow and we're going to core drill a hole here and get access into there. We're going to have two ductings. So we're going to have water and electricity, and they're going to come down, run through, obviously next to this footing that we've dug. So we're going to break up, crush all this. That's going to go to the other job or in a pile. Hopefully we should be able to do that now, shouldn't we? If we get this forklift in, so tomorrow I can move all this, spin that crush around, and just reverse the van right up. And as we crush it, just go straight onto the van so we don't have to load it onto the van again. That's the plan. And then we can dig a trench here with access chambers. So what I've got to decide now is where to put an access chamber. There's no point putting one here because the gate's going to be there. So the nearest one is probably going to be there, but then I'm not going to be able to put anything there because the gate's there. So the gate slides open there. So realistically, the next access chamber's there. So is there any point in putting two? I might as well just put one, mightn't I? One there and one at the end. And then I've got one there, and then it's whether to dig a trench and run one to the other side of the yard. It's probably worth doing. So I'd probably need one, two, three, four, five access chambers, and obviously however many meters of ducting, but we'll figure that out next time. Right, Lou, we're gonna get the forklift in, and then what do we say to people who are enjoying the channel? Subscribe. Hey, we need more subscribers so we can get more money for Simo, who doesn't even like us. Got obviously these metal tracks to get over where there's no steels to get the forklift in. However, I didn't realise it was a rear steering forklift, so I've just literally turned looking at the front wheels and it's just dropped off the pavement into here. Oh, so I'm gonna have to go and get the digger and try and like, I don't know, put some pressure on it and see if we can get it back level or something. Put a brick under or whatever. Oh! I said, didn't even video that, eh? So, you can see what we've just had that wheel. And then the front wheel got stuck, didn't it? So the front wheel, but he crushed the tarmac. So we were like, oh. So the two wheels were in it. I ended up having to get the digger and like push it with the digger. Yeah. We'll have to check they haven't moved though.
Hey. Oh, definitely moved the steel.
Did they? Oh, get the little spirit level on it then. I'll check it. Check it before it goes off.
The gate one.
So it's 6 o'clock and we are finally done. We managed to get the forklift onto the yard. However, because obviously all the weight at the back, I'll have to like pull it forward to the digger tomorrow. And as you can tell, we need a good tidy up on the yard now. It's so hard because obviously, so we kept floorboards from the house, any good ones that we can reuse. All these bricks need to go on the pallet, and I've got the forklift. Hopefully I can tidy everything up now, and then we're gonna, so tomorrow, I was meant to have Blaine here today, but he's away in the lakes. Hopefully tomorrow we can tidy all this up and get all the bricks stacked on pallets, all the half bricks crushed and on the tipper to thingy. And then I'm going to go to Burdens and pick up the access chambers and ducting, and we'll try and dig and get all the ducting in and then backfill it all and get it all this. Try and get all this tomorrow level. So if we go in the morning early while the lads are stacking bricks and whatever, maybe I can get to Burdens and get the ducting and the access chambers, and then if we get that in, you know, that's a massive, you know, bonus. It's good getting obviously these steels in level now, so when we do come to do the paving, obviously we've got something to level up to and then obviously across to. But yeah, it just needs a good tidy up, doesn't it? And then I'll, when I've got money, I'll order these panels. So they're like, I think they're like 3.5 grand for 10 concrete panels, but they're definitely going to be the way to go. And then obviously waiting on planning to say about the fence. It's relentless, isn't it? I've still got to straighten this bit up as well. So when we crush more hardcore, I'll, because we own from that corner to this corner, so this all needs to go sort of like that. However, just didn't have enough hardcore. What a Monday. Well, we got £455 this morning, so that will get us hopefully some stuff from Burdens tomorrow. And then we've pulled all this metal out the floor, and then there's a load of metal out the floor on the tipper down there. I just need loads of money to press go on everything at the minute at the yard. So it's like, we won the lottery, it'd be nice. I could just get everything sorted, but it's gonna be a busy day tomorrow getting this all. But it does need it. It definitely needs like tidying up, doesn't it? So these are gonna go in once we have the concrete slabs down. These will go on top then. And then we can put the scaffold poles in and get the CCTV up and the floodlights, like the whole yard then, which is what we want. But there's no point putting them in and then having to move them to, or maybe there is. No, there's not. It's wiring. As you can tell, I'm tired now, so I just need to go home so that my mind can have a rest as well as my body. Right, have a good Monday. I hope you have had as productive one. Well, could have went a lot better, but we got there in the end. Got the concrete in, the steels have set in, and that's another thing we'll look at then, sliding gates. So I want to try and get the front secure is number one, with gates on, proper gates. That would be my ideal scenario, and then start concreting it. So that's the plan. However, I'm waiting on planning to say about whether I can have concrete panels or not. But in my head, I can do the concrete panels and then I'll just put whatever fence they want in front of it. But I cannot see why they'd object to concrete panels. And then with timber clad in front of it, exactly like what was here in the first place. So, yeah. Well, anyway, subscribe.